Now, tonight we are on safari, scouring swamp and savannah alike for species starting with S. And look what we've found already, a snake in the grass, Josh Widdicombe. The seal of approval, Callie Beaton. The squid pro quo, Jamali Maddix. And he doesn't give a shih tzu, Alan Davis. Let's hear their calls of the wild. Josh goes. Callie goes. Jamali goes.
Wow.
Alan goes. Oh, it's supposed to be a snail. What's the world's second deadliest hunter?
Good one.
Yes. No. Honestly, sounds like you've got terrible asthma, which of course you do have.
Which I do have. what was the question?
What's the world's second deadliest hunter? I can tell you what the first is, if that's helpful to you.
Yeah, what is the first, then?
OK, so we did it on the O series. At the highest kill rate in nature, it has a 95% success rate.
Is it an ostrich?
No. An ostrich?
Callie?
Otter. It's otter.
Notoriously dangerous
ostrich. Is it an okapi? No.
No, weird, it doesn't even...
Octopus.
No.
Hippo?
No.
Is it a mosquito?
It's a dragonfly.
Oh, jeez.
It's a dragonfly.
And yet I went through all animals.
Yeah. It was good, though, to get a list going there. I like that. Hippo is very dangerous, darling. Very, very dangerous.
Thank you for telling me that, like, so I don't feel silly.
Yeah.
It's a good answer, but it's not the right one.
The weird thing about hippos is that they are tremendous killers, but they're vegetarians.
Yeah. Like me. Now, that is really hiding in plain sight. I'm a killer. I'm a killer. Vegetarian.
Yeah.
Vegetarian, did you know?
I wouldn't be surprised if you turned into a serial killer, darling. You look so weak from being a vegetarian.
No, it's the asthma that's made
me
weak.
Oh, is that what it is?
They're going in hard on your house.
It'll be awful, won't it, if I don't make it to broadcast.
Yeah.
Wow. Right, any more. Dragonfly, that's the first
hunter's
one.
Hunter's bird prey.
It's the dwarf seahorse.
Of course,
a dwarf seahorse.
I know. They're about 2 inches large. Kill 90% of the time that they try to catch some prey. Most fish of a similar size, they have about a 30 to 40% success rate. And there doesn't seem to be a marine predator with a better success rate. They hunt something called copepods. So they're tiny little crustaceans, which are usually excellent at escaping because they can swim more than 500 body lengths per second, right? That's the equivalent of me swimming at 2,700 kilometres per hour. And they also have some of the fastest reactions in nature. So dwarf seahorses, some of the slowest swimmers in the world. Top speed, about 5 foot an hour. But the key to their hunting success is their sort of horsey heads. And what it does, it allows them to sneak up on their prey. So copepods know that there's a predator because they sense the disturbance in the water. But the seahorse's head perfectly is formed to create no wake immediately above and in front of the nose. And they sort of sidle up. They're like ninjas. They sidle up to the copepod and it doesn't even notice. They can be like a millimetre away. And then the head snaps up and at the same time they suck inwards and they swallow the creature. We can show you a video of this. Oh. It looks so casual. It's just casually going along and there's a copepod.
Gone. What?
Yeah.
So you're saying that little thing can't see it? Because I think I would see a seahorse coming.
Yeah.
It's coming up from behind. I think you might...
Yeah, even from behind, I'd be like, is that a seahorse?
Seahorse,
that's
yeah.
What I'm saying.
Seems unfair. Seems like someone should be behind with some coconuts going... Cock, cock. Shut up! I'm hunting the time to chase this bug.
They have terrific eyesight, which also helps them. I'd like this. Their eyes move independently.
Of each other?
Of each other, ooh. Yeah. So one can look forwards and one can look backwards.
It's like my great-auntie Joan.
She was one of the great hunters as well, wasn't she?
Oh, stories in our family.
The sea's slowest swimmer is also its deadliest predator. What's all legs and no trousers or anything else very much?
Oh. It sounds like my daughter on Instagram, my teenage daughter.
Yeah, a lot of legs and no trousers.
Yeah, they do a lot of that, don't
posing.
They? Yeah. Mm.
Jamali's nodding. Like,
yeah. I'm not. Yeah, no, I've heard.
Have you?
No, that's
I've heard that there are women posing like that on Instagram.
Really?
I've never investigated. I don't even have Instagram. Whatever. Be quiet. No.
Sea spider.
Sea spider.
Sea spider. They are almost all leg. There's some. Look at these.
Ooh.
They are sometimes known as nobodies. I mean, they do actually have bodies, and they have a brain and a mouth and so on. They suck their prey through a proboscis. But the guts are in the legs, the genitals are in the legs, they breathe through their legs. The main problem is that they have such long legs, and I sympathise with this.
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
I've had this happen to me at the seaside. Sometimes barnacles and algae attach themselves. And that slows you right down.
I've got short legs.
Yeah.
How I genuinely have never, as an adult, had a pair of trousers that I haven't had to take up.
Yeah, but what you can do is cut that off and make a jacket. let's have a quick look at the way they walk. The interesting thing is, as they're walking, their way of breathing, they're absorbing oxygen from seawater, which is sucked in through holes in the legs. Mm. It is actually quite inefficient, but in, for example, high oxygen freezing waters of the Antarctic, it works well enough.
There doesn't seem to be much going for them, because you said even their way of getting the water in is not very effective.
Yeah. The dragon ones you show me, they're both a bit crap, isn't it?
You wouldn't want to be one of those.
No, I wouldn't want to be them or even look at them, really. I prefer a staff or something. That's just...
my favourite double S underwater animal, sea slugs, also known as nudibranchs.
Is that them?
Yes, I think they're rather marvellous. There's over 3,000 different species, and they have wonderful names like sea clown, shaggy mouse, the wet lemon, the white-spotted sea goddess, the hunchback Doris. I think they're rather beautiful, don't you?
And they're the same thing?
There's over 3,000 different species. They're the same type of animal.
Can they breed with each other?
No. Do you mean like taking a cocker spaniel and a poodle and making a dog?
Yeah,
no, I don't think that would work out at all. check out this next one, the green sea slug. It is one of the only animals to get its food from photosynthesis, so exactly like plants. And it does it by consuming algae and then stealing its chloroplasts, that's the cell parts that are responsible for photosynthesis, and making them work for it instead. So, honestly, it can eat simply by lying out in the sun.
Are you sure it's not just a leaf? It looks like a leaf to me, and you're just explaining the leaf.
This is the initiation on QI.
Things are rarely as they seem.
No.
How big's that then?
An inch or two.
Inch or two.
Yeah. So
Alan was like 2 inches.
Yeah.
We're like, no.
Describe a new way snakes are found to get about. Yes, my darling.
Is it one of those motorised scooters?
I think they're...
That shouldn't be allowed on the pavement, if you ask me, Sandy.
Yes, that's at the age I've reached, I go, look at that, and if he hit me, he's not insured.
Too right.
Yes.
They are snakes, the people on them, yes. I tell you that for free.
They have no lights. No lights, no manners.
Have you ever been on one?
No, is it...
No, I would love to go on one.
I ride them all the time. I ride them through the shopping centre with a gang of other kids. Don't start stealing through. Oh, we have a great time.
That's why I want to be friends with you. You make me look more modern.
Yeah. Wow. Cheers, mate.
They go, snakes go quickly if you pee on them.
I mean, you'd have to be confident, wouldn't you?
I'd say same with humans.
Yeah. So I was in Yosemite and I went quietly off a road to do a pee and I went down the slope and then I peed on a snake and it came hairing out. Do they hair? And then I ran up the slope and I was naked from here to my knees because I hadn't pulled everything back up and there was a coachload of Japanese tourists. But, yeah, it didn't like being peed on. Because it almost looked like it went in a straight line. You know they normally do that.
Ah, well, they move in lots of different ways.
Well, it seemed like it went off like a...
It can do.
Rocket.
It's called a rectilinear movement.
It's been ages since I had an erectolinear movement in Yosemite.
So there was an issue on the island of Guam with snakes, particularly the brown snake. And in 2016, the conservationists were having a look to see how they could prevent them getting to birds' nesting boxes. So they placed a camera next to a nest of mice at the top of an 8-inch-wide betel pole in an enclosure that held 58 snakes, OK? And when they viewed the footage, and this nobody knew this was a possibility, they saw a snake wind its tail around the pole then hold on to the other end of the body to form a loop and then inch its way up the pole. And it is called a lasso locomotion. Let's take a look. I have to say there are lots of different techniques for it.
It's like string fellows, isn't it?
It takes you back.
Speak for yourself, Sandy.
Well, we needed the work. But look at that.
You must like these, Jamal. Are these good?
Yeah, Jamal, they're cool. I was just curious. I don't know if is that like a new evolution or is that something they've done forever and we've just noticed now?
It's probably the fact that they've been doing it for a very long time. It's that we've only recently observed it. They now think this is the fifth way of moving. So typically there's the slithering, then there's what's called sidewinding, then there's concertina, and then the rectilinear, and then this one now, the new lasso locomotion.
You get flying snakes, don't you? The reason I know this is because my son's a zookeeper, I know about animals.
I've got a bit of news for you, Callie. Your son is taking the piss out of you.
Don't care, man. Look out, it's a flying snake!
Yeah, they jump and glide through the air. Yeah. That's correct, yeah.
They just fall out of trees.
Yeah, well, maybe.
What animals? Is he a particular animal that he's interested in?
He's doing research on the slow loris.
OK, which is...?
Not quick.
I'm glad you've been paying attention.
It's the only venomous primate.
There it is, the slow loris. Oh, it looks so cute, doesn't it?
Sizing you up to kill you.
Just like a dwarf seahorse.
Like Josh.
It is like you without your glasses on, isn't it? That's so sweet.
Yeah, well, I'd say the glasses isn't the only difference, but yeah.
That is cute, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all right.
You're a tough crowd for animals.
No, I'm joking. I love animals. I like snakes a lot. I remember when I grew up, there was always a guy on the estate who had snakes and your mum never wanted you to hang out with him.
You sure there were snakes?
Because he was like a weird guy.
Well, the brown tree snake is a serious problem in Guam. They probably arrived on cargo or military ships during World War II, and it has decimated the bird population. It's wiped out 10 native species, and that in turn decimated the island's trees because they relied on the birds to spread the seeds, and new tree growth fell by 90% as the birds died out.
Why don't they bring, like, a mongoose and just let off a bunch of mongoose to then deal with the brown snakes?
Then you'll have a mongoose problem. What
and then you bring something for the mongoose. Yes. You know what I'm saying? It's just a chain of events.
Then you bring the seahorse in and it takes out the mongoose.
What they do now, when they've got a pole with a nesting box on it, they put a cone. They put the narrowest point of the cone facing down
like that.
Signs
saying no snakes.
Yes. But if there's a wider part of the cone like that, the snake has to let go. It makes it fall off the pole. Oh, I've got another type of movement. This you're going to love. The Chihuahuan hook-nosed snake farts defensively when it is threatened. It's technically called cloacal popping, OK? So they expel air from their cloaca. They have one hole for reproduction, for digestion, so it's all just one hole at the bottom. And it makes an audible noise, and sometimes they do it so aggressively, this farting, that it lifts them into the air.
Oh, wow!
I've dated people like that. It's awful.
That's terrible, isn't it?
Isn't that a skill? To be able to lift yourself up with your fart.
See? These are the animals I wanted to see.
OK.
Is it true that, talking of a snake's genitals, is it true that a male snake has two penises, or peni? I just thought I'd throw that out
there. Which would you prefer, two heads or two penises?
Two penises.
OK.
What about you, Jamal?
Two penises.
Is that a thing?
Not next to one another.
I'd have one in the regular place and one on my left hand.
Instead of a finger?
Instead of a finger. I'd always wear a glove. Yeah. Why does he wear a glove? He's got a cock hand. I think I'd have four other fingers. I don't think I'd just have the cock.
No.
Just pull the glove off.
Yeah. You wouldn't want to look weird, would you?
No. I think it would always be like that, or would it sometimes be like that?
Sometimes it'd be like that.
Yeah.
OK. Awkward, though, wouldn't it? When you couldn't stop your finger. Like an umpire.
I'm sorry I brought it up, Sam. Yeah.
Whereas a second head, what is the point of that?
Well, you wouldn't be lonely. You'd
chat. You could talk amongst yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Would we have different personalities?
Oh, imagine. It could be like one leave, one remain.
Yeah.
Oh, then you'd have an anti-vaxxer on you. Oh, they're trying to trace your every move. It's all a hoax.
If you had two penises, it would be a pair of hemipenes.
Is there anyone that has more than two?
Philip Schofield.
Right, moving on. What would you use a thunderstone for? You should have one beside you. This is a thunderstone. What do you think it is?
It looks a bit fossily, my one.
Yeah. It is fossily.
It looks like a sourdough bread.
It does look a bit like a sourdough bread.
Don't eat.
Right, that's showing how middle class I've become. It's like sourdough bread. What happened to me?
Yeah. Did you see Jamali on QI going on about that?
Bro, I could never go back to where I came from.
Even the man who keeps snakes near you doesn't want to talk to you.
Don't go around his house, he's weird. That's the snake guy.
Fossilised sea urchins, they were thought by Scandinavians to have been forged from thunder and found when lightning had struck. And as people believed that lightning would never strike in the same place twice, you would keep one in your house to protect yourself. But it is, in fact, a fossilised sea urchin.
Cool.
And also, because it's Scandinavia, keep the trolls away, stop your horses getting nightmares, look after your milk. You put one on the shelf in the dairy to keep the milk fresh and so on.
Was the horse nightmare, was that a big thing?
The horse is so important to you, I suppose you just don't want anything to happen to it. Do you know what I think?
It's a shame that the horse can't hunt in total silence.
Like a seahorse.
Like a seahorse.
Yeah.
Imagine they've got a cat. I mean, if they ate cats... And only cats.
Yeah.
And no one could stop them.
Well, no. We can all dream, Alan.
You can't hear them. That was a cat. Well, there's a horse here. It can't be the horse.
Right, moving on. Which silent saboteur scuppered the Spanish Armada? It's an animal beginning with S.
Snake.
Salamander.
Snail.
Ships. Nail. Something to do with ships.
Shiptics.
Shiptics.
Shiptics. What? Like a tick, but on a ship. Shiptick.
Oh, I like that. Kind of.
Yeah.
Kind of.
Kind of, in a funny sort of way. It's shipworm.
That's not a thing.
It's woodworm of the sea. It's a type of mollusk. It's a kind of clam. It's not actually a worm, really, at all. And it loves to eat wooden ships. And it was partly responsible for the defeat of the Spanish Armada. Here is a picture, and they are amazing. Basically, there are a pair of very small shells at one end with which they can drill the passage, OK? And also, because you open them like this, they can stop the passage that they're drilling falling in on themselves. And the reason this is really important is that the great engineer, Mark Brunel, looked at shipworms and how they were working, and that is how he created the tunnelling device with which he made the very first tunnel under a navigable river under the Thames, and it was the shipworms that enabled that to happen. But they did help defeat the Spanish Armada because they weakened the structure of the larger and more powerful Spanish ships and made them vulnerable to storms and to cannonballs and so on. And they're possibly more responsible for the Spanish defeat than either the weather or indeed the English Navy. In modern terms, they can be considered the great recyclers of the sea because they process a resource that most animals cannot eat, so wood. And it was a problem for them when copper bottoms came into shipping. I mean, the thing that there's an old copper bottoms boat.
That's my username on Tinder. What? Old copper bottom.
Now it's time to swoop straight into a round of general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. What shape do bees make honeycombs into?
Hexagon.
It was previously thought that bees built their honeycombs out of hexagons. And there's a lot of people thought, how have they done that? Have they made a perfect hexagon? How did
Well, when you say previously thought, I mean, what you can do is actually look at it.
Yeah.
There it is.
So, what they've actually... what they've actually done...
The famous honeycomb shape.
They create circular-shaped cells using their own bodies as a mould.
Yes.
And then those form a hexagonal shape by themselves, the same way that bubbles sit together in a bubble bath.
What kind of bees make milk? No. That's the important question.
Yeah. The point is, we thought that...
Boobies.
Have you been home educating your kids? How is that going?
This is the tone of voice.
They're not going to get...
Of homeschooling in the Davis household.
Yeah.
Just do it and then bring it to me. Try to do it. Tried to do it. I can't read that.
So, well, the point is, Alan, that we thought that bees knew how to...
Never mind the point is, Alan. You know the hexagons and you've shown some weird bee... Not actually in a honeycomb. Oh, this is a good picture where it's not a hexagon. Find a proper one. Your own time you're wasting.
That picture is hexagonal, though.
Yeah, no, but it's not as good as some of them.
Right.
like the ones what you can actually buy in certain shops.
OK.
What's that? The bee shop, the honeycomb shop.
Yeah. Well, how can you tell if your dog's happy to see you?
Oh, they're not.
They wag their tails, Andy.
Oh, dear.
And again. The evidence is widespread.
The tail wagging does not necessarily indicate happiness. It's a kind of communication. They are trying to signal submissiveness. For example, inferior wolves would wag their tails when approaching superior ones. But if it was happiness, when the dog is alone, it would wag its tail if suddenly it saw some food or something, and they don't do that. It is a way of trying to communicate either with another dog or with the person. It's a bit like fidgeting. It can be excitement or it can be nerves.
How do we know? How do we know it doesn't
wag its tail?
I mean, if a dog wags its tail and no one's there to see it,
can't
we really say it hasn't wagged its tail?
There's this new thing called cameras. How can you make your cat smile at you?
Oh, cats, don't start with cats. I used to have two, and one would go to the top of the curtains, and the other one would rip the curtains down trying to get it. That sums them up. Sums them up.
Molly, have you got cats or dogs?
I had a dog. Well, I only had a dog for like a week once, because.
Wasn't it your dog?
Yeah, kind of. So I had this bike, and then a guy said to me, I want to buy the bike. He goes, I'll trade you. And I go, what you got? And he goes, I've got nunchucks. So I got the nunchucks. And I said, you got to chuck in 20 quid. He went, all right, cool. So I went home. My mum's like, where's your bike? I was like, I've only got nunchucks and 20 quid. And she's like, well, no, go back and get your bike. And I went back and I was like, I need my bike back. And he goes, all right, but I'll give you this dog instead. And I went, all right. So I took the dog back. And then someone's knocked at my house because that guy had stole the dog.
Oh, my word.
So I had to then give the dog back. But I got to keep the nunchuck, so it's a happy ending.
Sandy, do you know what a nunchuck is?
What I do know is that Jamali and I have very different lives.
That's a dog I had once.
Wow. OK. Tough. How can you make your cat smile at you?
Can they smile?
Can they smile?
Can they smile, Josh?
Well, I've got two cats. They have never smiled.
Okay.
They haven't got like animated
it's
mouths.
It's something
have
that
they?
Callie said early on about snakes.
You rub both their penises in their ears.
You urinate on it.
You?
Yes.
I'm not going to check that. When I get home and I say to my wife, here's a trick for you. Yeah. Go and get the cat.
Yeah. I thought he was going to say, go and get the camera.
So you make an expression that looks like a smile, but it's actually something called a Flamen response. It means to bare the upper teeth. And it means that they're analysing a smell, so a smell like urine, and drawing the scent particles into the roof of the mouth. Uh-huh. If you weed on a cat, it would look like it was smiling. In fact, the best way to make your cat happy is to slowly blink at it. So
while you're peeing or just as
no, don't think you need to pee. They're more likely to approach if you have an outstretched hand indicating trust, but if you've been slow blinking at it, then they think that must be okay.
But everyone else in your house is like, we're going to call a doctor.
we're just going to bring on the cat.
Slow blinking and pissing on the cat.
You could learn many things from your puppy dog's tails. Speaking of which, what are little boys made of?
They were sugar and spice smells. And all girls. No.
Girls were
sugar and spice and all things nice.
And boys?
Bad shit.
Bad shit.
That's it.
Cigarette smoke and petrol. I don't know.
Cigarette smoke and petrol. Yeah.
Slugs and snails and puppy dogs' tails.
Oh, yes.
But there have been lots of versions of the rhyme. So from the 1820s, it had snips and snails, snigs and snails, or snakes and snails. A snig is a young eel. And a snip is a sort of morsel of something, and then longer versions with old men made of slippers that flop and a bald-headed top. Women are reels and jeels and old spinning wheels. The truth is, little boys and little girls are actually made mostly of water, like almost all other living things. I want you to put these pictures in order of which contains the most water.
Cucumber
at number one, we agree on that?
What about a slug?
Slug? We're going to go for slug number two?
A baby.
For number three?
Yeah.
OK, then?
I've always thought women are more watery than men. I've said it for years.
You can't say those things anymore.
Oh, I can't say that anymore. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Am I going to be cancelled for that, am I?
Is that not a compliment, then?
No.
No?
Do you know, Callie, you're looking particularly watery today.
Number number four?
I'm going to say...
It's a middle-class story.
Yeah, but...
Spent
all day chatting to the cook, doing no work.
He said he's never seen snails like it. Anyway, I wish I hadn't brought him up. He's not even a part of the story.
He is now.
Anyway, I got this organic thing, because I felt bad, but, it said... That I put it down, and it said the snail will... don't worry, it's fine. Snails eat it and then they just burrow underground.
Right, and die.
Well, they didn't mention that, but I presume that's what happened.
Yeah. It's like a vegetarian's way of getting rid of ants.
Yeah. Why don't you just put, like, I was going to say salt, but Himalayan pink sea salt.
Yeah, that's... Yeah.
It's more what you would... Yeah. I was going to say normal table salt, but I know you... Why don't you go out there and say... That grinder. Josh, don't waste the salt. I have to, darling.
He'd have got the cook to do that. They did a study of throwing snails. 416 snails, they threw them over a wall and then they were marked and then thrown again if they returned, and one snail came back 17 times. And that brings our safari to a slimy close. Let's take a swift look at the scores. In last place, moving at a snail's pace with minus 19, it's Alan. With minus 17, Jamali.
I'm proud of that. Can I just say at this point, I've never won.
Me neither.
Okay. In second.
And just to note, my gardener is a huge fan of the show.
This has never happened before. This sort of tension.
In second place with minus 6, it's Callie. Yeah! With the lion's share and 3 whole points, it's Josh Widdicombe! Thanks to Callie, Jamali, Josh and Alan. I leave you with this from American columnist Doug Larson. Never doubt the courage of the French. They were the ones who discovered that snails are edible. Good night. We'll be right back.